Good morning. Rufus, you are forgiven. We're growing together as followers of Jesus. You know, this is our focus. This is what we want to do as a church. As a church, as individuals, we want to grow. We want to grow together. And we want to grow together to follow Christ. It's really a privilege to share God's word this morning and to share my heart for the church and how we all can grow together as followers of Christ. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. Father, we just pray that you open up our eyes to see you, open up our ears to hear you, open up our hearts to receive you. We thank you for all things and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning, we continue with a sermon series on Paul's letter to the Ephesians. The title of my sermon is United. There are many things that Paul exhorts us to do in the book of Ephesians. And those familiar with the ending of Ephesians will know that Paul gives out many instructions on Christian living. There are specific instructions to masters, to slaves, to husbands, wives, parents, children. But undergirding all these instructions, undergirding all this is a spirit of unity, of being united in Christ. Last week, Pastor Lynette opened this sermon series with a sermon on blessings. So you are blessed by adoption. You are now in God's family. Well, this is adoption. This is also true for every other member of Christ's family. We are all united in Christ. You are blessed by redemption. Our sins are washed away. And this is also true for every other Christian united in Christ. You are blessed by an inheritance. Well, so is every other Christian. We all look forward to a heavenly reward to be united with Christ. So we all have a common heritage. We all have a common destiny. And therefore, we share in common, in unity, a life with one another in the present. We are united by Christ in all these spiritual truths and blessings. You know, as we read Ephesians more and more, we start seeing all these links in the text. We start seeing links between the chapters, and really there's a unity in the whole letter that Paul wrote. Last week, Pastor Lynette encouraged us to read Ephesians every day. Every morning, I read Ephesians. And in this sermon series, I'm committed to reading it every day, to getting into this letter, all it has to say for us, all it has to say for AMC. You know, I try to read different versions. I try to get the nuances of the different translations. And some days, if I have time, I read the whole letter right through. Some days, I just meditate on certain verses or certain chapters. You know, can we do that? We don't have a reading plan for Ephesians, but in this whole sermon series, let's get to reading Ephesians over, over and over again and commit to growing together as followers of Jesus. Well, we saw spiritual blessings in Ephesians 1. Because of these blessings, we have a common heritage, a common destiny, and now a common united life with one another in the present. And it actually links to our current passage in Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2 also speaks of a common past. Ephesians 2 also looks forward to a common future. And Ephesians 2 also asks us to do a common work of being united one to another in Christ. Let me read our passage this morning, and it comes from the New International Version, Ephesians 2, verses 1 to 13 and 19 to 22. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. Verse 4, but because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, in which God prepared in advance for us to do. Verse 11. Therefore, remember that formerly you, who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. And verse 19, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Well, every week, the preacher gets the privilege or the task of selecting songs for the worship service. And the hope is that the preacher can unite the whole service with a common theme. As usual, Eric would email me on what songs I want to sing. And this week I asked him to just go ahead and select the songs based on the theme of being united. I didn't tell him I actually had a song in mind, but it may not have been very appropriate. Well, we read about the glory of Jesus Christ, how his resurrection now appropriated by man, and that now man is united with one another. So what song can I choose to emphasize the themes of glory, man, and united? The only one I could think of was this. Glory, glory, man united. Glory, glory, man united. Okay, Rufus will cut off my mic if I sing some more. So I better stop here. But jokes aside, the theme of reconciliation, the working out of reconciliation towards a united community, are very strong in this passage. And it's actually the structure of our passage this morning that traces this argument for being united. In a few verses before the passage we read, in Ephesians 1, 19 to 23, Paul speaks about the glorification of Jesus Christ very strongly. And the verses reads, that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. This Jesus here, Paul's talking about him. He is far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. God placed all things under his feet, under Jesus' feet, and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. So Paul, he's telling us of the greatness of Jesus, the glory of Christ. And in Ephesians 1, 19 to 23, he emphasizes this glory. The next section we read in Ephesians 2, 1 to 3, Paul contrasts this with our past sins. But now, through his love, God allows us to participate in Christ's glory through salvation. And we see this in Ephesians 2, verses 4 to 10. In the next section, in Ephesians 2, 11 to 12, while we can experience Christ's glory, Paul also asks us to remember the problems of a past life without Christ, and we are not to revert to this hopeless situation. And finally, the message. In Ephesians 2, 13 to 22, we now are invited, he invites all of us to participate in Christ's glory through reconciliation, through unity. Verse 19 reads, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, members of His household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone. In Him, the whole building, not this physical building, but all of us, we are joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in Him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. The ministry of Jesus is a ministry of reconciliation, with the goal being united, reconciled, God to man and man to one another. And we get these blessings in Christ. All sons and daughters of God, we are siblings with one another. No son or daughter is better than the other because we are all in Christ. In the words of the Holy Communion Liturgy, which we heard last week, we say, by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at His heavenly banquet. So when we take the elements, when we partake of the sacrament that God has given us, we remember that we are all in Christ. And we continue to ask for this unity over and over and over. You know, we recognize that we cannot do it on our own strength, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. We are to be united with Christ, united with one another, united in ministry. In our passage this morning in Ephesians 2, the terms Paul uses, in Him, in Christ, with Him, all similar terms are used more than 10 times. And that's the critical aspect of being united, is being in Christ. We are united to one another because, and only because, we are in Christ. So no matter my background, I can call myself united with Liang Chiang, with Vincent, especially since he wears a Man U jersey, even with Rufus, who has a conviction different from my own. While the world can speak of a universal brotherhood of man, and in some sense we are connected to our fellow man, but true Christian unity is found in Christ. All of us had no hope before Christ. And when you are in Christ, all the riches of His glory are available to every single one of us. The passage we read contains a very loved verse, Ephesians 2, verses 8 to 9. It is a cornerstone of our faith. It's only by God's grace are we saved. This is not a work of our own, or our own merit, and salvation is a work of God. We were all once in sin, but by God's grace, His immeasurable love, we have been saved. Jesus died to cleanse us from our sins. And once we believe in Him, we believe in this truth for our lives, we are saved. We become accepted as His family. We become united in Him. Oftentimes when we quote Scripture, we often stop there. And I don't blame you. I took out an old Bible of mine. My dad gave me this Bible. And when I flipped to Ephesians 2, the only verses I highlighted are verses 8 and 9. You know, the next verse, Ephesians 2:10, is equally, or if not more important. In verse 10, the effect of our salvation is that we are created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Therefore, the truth of our salvation must be enacted by us in the world. The truth that we are saved, the truth that we are united, must be shown to everyone around us in the here and now. There are many, many spiritual truths we can glean from this passage. But this morning, as we seek to grow together as followers of Jesus, I want to encourage us to grow in unity, to grow to be more united with one another. How do we apply this spiritual truth in our life? Once we are in Christ, we are united with one another, you might say. Yes, this is the objective truth for all believers, for all Christians. But how do I make it subjectively true for me? The ministry of Jesus is the ministry of reconciliation. The goal, to connect man to God and man to man. So what is said about Jesus in Ephesians 1:19 to 21, his glorification is now being applied to all Christians. So we are all called to his glory. Therefore, we are all called to his reconciling work of unity. We are called to participate in the glory of Christ through the participation in the ministry of unity. Unity, being united. This happened in Christ, but we get to enact this in the world. We are objectively united to God. We are objectively united to one another. This happened in an instant when we believed in Jesus. However, subjectively, we need to work out its effects in our own lives. Paul asks us, work out your salvation in the world we live in. I give you an example. At the start of this new year, many children started a new school. Any kids here started a new school? One over there. But my daughter also started a new school. She started nursery. She's 2.5. And it was a bad start to the year. There were a lot of tears and crying. Hopefully it ends next week, but I cannot be certain. So some of us went to a new primary school in Fairfield. We had an opening chapel for them. Some of us went to a new secondary school, maybe a new JC, a new poly, a new university. You know, when you start a new school, when you go to a new place, objectively, you are in the school. You are a member of Fairfield. However, you're still new. You know, it takes some time for you to imbibe the school spirit. You don't automatically feel that you belong. And you need some time to know its values, to understand what it all means, to actually belong in a school. And how do you enact this? How do you work this out? Well, as a student, you work it out by participating in school programs. You get involved in a CCA. You join so many other community groups in school. Well, you learn the school song. You sing it in the morning. You live the life of the school. You slowly but surely, you gain the school spirit. You enact the school culture, and then you grow. You grow in the school. You feel like you belong. You feel united. You know, for adults, it's the same. You start a new job. You don't automatically feel like you belong. When you start a new job, it takes some time to learn an office culture, to learn to live it day by day. You know, in your work, it's not just about work, work, and work. You get to participate in the life of the firm. You feel more connected. You feel more united with one another in the firm. Growing together as followers of Jesus, the Christian life is not static. The Christian life is a life of growth, a life of growth in Christ. How do we as Christians, being united with one another, grow and participate in Christ's work of unity? How do we enact this unity brought about by Jesus, brought about by this united body of Christ? Well, can I suggest to us this morning three practical applications? One is in our family, our natural family. Two is in our local church, Aldersgate. And three is in the church universal. We want to be united in our families. We want to be united in our church, in Aldersgate. We want to be united in the church of Jesus Christ. United in the family. You know, sometimes we show Christian love to those around us, but somehow we neglect to show it to those who are supposed to be closest to us. There's a saying, familiarity breeds contempt. And the meaning is that, you know, if we know someone too well, we spend too much time with that person, we can risk losing respect for that person, taking him or her for granted. Sometimes it happens in my own life. Is it true for you that familiarity breeds contempt? You think, no matter what you do, they'll always love me. No matter what you do, they'll always be there for you. So we take them for granted. or spending too much time with someone puts us in this pressure cooker environment where every small flaw, every small problem is accentuated. You know, we spend so much time with our family, especially last year, it's easy to get a bit irritated at them. So I was reading up, there are many secular strategies on how we can keep our family together, how we can promote unity. But can I suggest to us one from our text this morning? Our family, our natural family, should not just be our natural family. It should also be our spiritual family. If we, believers, are in one household, we are not just husband and wife. We are not just father and daughter or mother and son. We are all brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we all have the same adoption into the body of Christ. We are all equally sinners, redeemed by Jesus' blood, and ultimately we share in the same inheritance. You know, in our natural families, when we see each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, we have another reason to look out for one another, to nurture one another, to sacrifice for one another, to love one another with the love of Jesus Christ. You know, in our families, let us not let familiarity breed contempt. Let us not just strive for parental love, grandparental love, love between a husband and a wife, or a child's love. Let us strive to love one another as Christ has loved us. You know, when we speak to one another in our family, let us speak to one another as a brother or a sister in Christ. When we interact with someone in our family, let us act as a fellow brother or sister in Christ. This is one way we can become more united in our families. And the second way we can become more united is in our local church, in AMC. What do I mean? Are we not a united church? Well, we are sitting so far apart. It doesn't look very united. But don't get me wrong. I think we are very united, but we all can grow in unity. We can all make more inroads to reduce any barriers that are between us. You know, we have so many ministries in church, and sometimes we ask this question, does it fall within outreach and social concerns, or is it witness in evangelism? You know, we do have ministries to take the leads on various programs, but let us not see that this part is my ministry, you know, that part is your ministry. Well, this is AMC. This is our ministry. I remember when I first joined AMC, Joel Tan was very kind to organize a lunch with me and some of the young adults in church. And when we were walking out to lunch, Sharon Tay came along and she says, I know I'm not a young adult, but can I join you? Can I join in? Of course, we welcomed Sharon with open arms. And I just felt really encouraged that she felt very comfortable enough to sit down with us and, in her own words, gate crash. You know, when we feel united as a church, when we are united as a church, we feel comfortable enough to sit down and talk with one another, ask questions. Because honestly, if we are family, if we are united, then my business is your business and your business is my business. There's no mine and this is yours. And we are entitled, in Sharon's words, to gate crash one another because we are united as a church family. We need to find more ways to collaborate with one another, to break down barriers between us. You know, when someone tries or wants to be included, we should welcome them with open arms. I encourage you, go serve in a ministry you have never served in before. You're not used to it. Let us learn the church, life of the church. Let us work towards being a more united church. In the recent Christmas outreach project, you know, the Chinese ministry spearheaded the Light Up Dover project. And I want to thank Preacher Anna for, you know, really starting to organize this. And we went to reach out to one of the blocks in Dover Road. And this was not just a Chinese ministry project. Many people from other ministries, WNE, WSES, they came together and said, yo, we wanted to join. We want to do outreach together. And we continue to work. And in Chinese New Year, we continue to do outreach as a big church family. And this is a wonderful example of being united. You know, can we continue to build bridges with one another? Can we continue to collaborate as a church with one another? One way to become more united in church is this idea of collaboration. Another way that I want to encourage all of us to be more united as a church, to join ourselves to the church, is through baptism and membership. Maybe you have come to AMC for a while now, or attending online for a while now, and you're not yet a member of the church. Well, one way you can enact unity, one way you can grow to becoming more united in Christ's body, is to get baptized, is to become a member of a local church, of AMC. You know, our salvation is not dependent on baptism or membership. But baptism and membership is one way we enact our unity in the church. By choosing to identify with a body of believers, by formally committing to loving, to serving, to living with one another, you are saying, yes, I want to take the next step to be more united in the body of Christ. Like I said before, when we become Christian, we are objectively joined and united to the body of Christ. But baptism and membership is an expression of this transformation. As we always say, it is an outward sign of an inward change. You know, when we formally commit to something, it will help us grow. Is that true? When we formally commit to being a member of the church, I guarantee you, you will see spiritual growth and transformation in your own life. At the start of the year, many people make resolutions. And how many of us here made a resolution? I guess, okay, some, good, at the back. The back benches are better than the people in front. But anyway, every year, I make a resolution. I make a resolution to exercise more every year. You know, sometimes it's difficult to get this going, but when you put your money where your mouth is, then things will start to change. So I always go out and buy new stuff. It's not for the sake of buying new stuff. It's for the sake of my body. So I go out and buy new running shoes, basketball shoes. I just go out and get new exercise gear. So I just bought a tennis bag from Decathlon. I opened up this new box of Air Jordans that I was saving up to play basketball this season. You know, I put my money where my mouth is. Now I'm all fired up to exercise, to run, to play basketball, to play tennis. A physical action, a determined commitment, will spur a drive to be connected, and in this case, to sports and exercise. What happens if I made this resolution to exercise, then I open my cupboard, and I don't see any shoes? I see a tennis racket, but its strings are broken. My basketball is furry and worn out. What do you think will happen? I will just say, forget it. Today is not the day. Maybe I'll start tomorrow. And tomorrow never comes. Do you get where I'm going? If we want to grow in Christ, if we want to be more united, if we want to get connected to the body, then consider this. Take the next step. Be baptized. Consider being a member. This is a practical step of growing together as followers of Jesus. If you want to know more, you can sign up for the baptism and membership class that we're starting in February. The details are in your bulletins, and you need more information, you can always reach out to me, Pastor Lynette, or Preacher Wendy. Now, for those of us, I'm already baptized. I'm already a member. That is great. Hallelujah. But we can still further enact our unity in Christ. We can take this extra step to be more united and grow. And how do we do that? Join a cell group. By doing this, by joining a cell group, you are saying, yes, I want to be accountable to other Christian brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to grow together. I want to be committed to being united with others, to share a life with others all its ups and all its downs. I don't want to live like a foreigner. I don't want to live like a stranger. I want to belong to the body. I want to be united to the body. And so how can we enact our unity in Christ? We need to take active, practical steps to becoming more united. We can take the step of faith to get baptized. We can take the step of faith to formally becoming a member of the church. We can take the step of faith to join a cell group. So the first way we can become more united is to enact the unity of Christ in our families. The second way we can become more united is to enact the unity of Christ in our church. We can collaborate in service, get baptized, be a member, join a cell group. And the third way we can become more united, is to understand the greater church of Jesus Christ and what unity means in the universal body of Christ. And that's what Paul is saying exactly in our passage. Being united in the church of Jesus Christ, it has a much broader implication than these four walls. It has a much broader implication than our families. Being united with other fellow believers means that we understand the different denominations, traditions, and we see all of us as equals. I'm very proud of our Methodist tradition. But being united means that we do not see Methodists or even Protestants as being better than other traditions or denominations. You know, there are many things that we can learn from other denominations, from Catholics, from Orthodox Christians. Being united does not mean being uniform. Unity does not equal uniformity. Our new bishop, Bishop Gordon, said this in a sermon he preached during his consecration service last December. We all have the right to disagree, but we do not have the right to be disagreeable. We all have the right to disagree, but we do not have the right to be disagreeable. Different denominations and traditions. We may disagree with one another in certain aspects of theology, church polity, but we are all one in Christ. We are in Christ. We can work together to show the world that Christians are a loving community. No infighting, no comparing which church is better than the other. You know, local churches, large or small, wealthy or not so wealthy, independent or like us from a mainline denomination, all of us have a part to play in the body of Christ. You know, the Holy Spirit built this church and all its diversity. There are some places that some local churches can go. That is their mission. There are some places that we as AMC can go. That is our mission. And together, we build the body of Christ. You know, we are all members of Jesus' household, built on the foundations of apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus Himself as a cornerstone. It is in Christ Jesus that the whole building, the whole body of Christ, is joined together. May we as a church rise up in unity to be His holy temple in Christ, a place where God resides, a place where the love of God can be shown to the world. Let us grow together. As followers of Jesus, you enact out this unity in the body of Christ, in our families, in AMC, and in a church universal. Amen.